Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov, known as Lenin, was born in 1870 in Russia, and that was a time of developing crisis in Russian society and the development of capitalism in Russia, as a matter of fact. The big movement at that time in his early years was the Narodniks, which really was based on the peasantry, of the need to get rid of the Tsar. And many of them have reverted to individual terrorism in order to carry out their actions. And Lenin's brother was a member of this organization, and he was involved in an attempted assassination of the Tsar. He was caught, arrested, and hanged. And Lenin at that time was 17 years of age. He was in school and became interested in socialism and Marxism, which he carried on into his student days. Of course, being a revolutionary, he was expelled from university, although he does carry out his degree in law. Although he doesn't become a lawyer, he becomes a professional revolutionary. And Lenin himself begins to be involved in the 1890s in small circles of workers and students, primarily students. The students and the intelligentsia played a very important, key and leading role at this time in Russia. But it was a time of developing capitalism, and unlike the working class in Britain, which took 200-300 years to develop, and with it craft unionism and so on, in Russia, the peasantry were thrown into the cauldron of industry and opened them up to fresh ideas, new ideas. Above all, the ideas of socialism and Marxism. They were a virgin working class. Of course, you couldn't organize freely in Russia at this time. It was a dictatorship. And therefore, any attempt at revolution was met with a suppression, with imprisonment, and of exile. The earliest Russian Marxist group was the Emancipation of Labor Group, set up by a man called George Plekhanov. He became known as the father of Russian Marxism. We'll go into this a bit more perhaps when we go to the Marx Memorial Library, where we'll be able to discuss further the origins of the Marxist movement in Russia and of Bolshevism and so on and so forth. Well, but Lenin met Plekhanov in 1895 and tried to discuss with him the need for an all-Russian newspaper to develop an organization, because the social democracy did not exist at that time in Russia, only in small little groups. But Lenin was arrested soon afterwards and sent into exile. And he was only freed from exile in 1900. So 5 of these years are in Siberia. And in 1900, they formed the Iskra movement, the Iskra newspaper, which again we'll go into in a bit further detail later. Unfortunately, this walk doesn't take place in a chronological fashion. We come here because the nearest point from where we started, and across the road we'll see a flat where Lenin lived in 1908. So we're going a bit further into our time, but we'll go back sooner or later as we move down towards Sidmouth Street, which is just around the road. So let's go and see this in Tavistock Place, where Lenin lived in 1908, and what he was doing at that time in London. So let's cross the road and have a look. It's May of that year, and Lenin comes to London and spends 1 month here. Comes to London for a particular purpose, and that is to do research. Goes to the British Museum, the British Library, and the reason for this research is because of an attack on Marxism that occurs at this time. And the reason for the attack was because of the ebb in the defeat of the first Russian Revolution of 1905. The 1905 revolution lasted a year. Tremendous battles, tremendous movements, and eventually it was defeated at the end of 1905, and then they set in a counter-revolutionary period. period of repression above all. And this repression led to enormous demoralization and a reaction. And with this reaction, you have individuals, even who supported Lenin at this time, who started to try and revise the ideas of Marxism on Marxist philosophy. There's people like Bogdanov and Lunacharsky who again supported Lenin ever since 1903 in the Second Congress, nevertheless started to take up on these strange ideas, these revisionist ideas. At that time in Austria and Germany, they also had these ideas, revisionist ideas. Said the new sciences meant they should revise Marxism. And they came forward with the idea perhaps you can combine religion with Marxism. Therefore, it was a real challenge to dialectical materialism, the basic philosophy of materialist philosophy of Marxism. And as a result, Lenin saw this as a big challenge, and therefore he came to London and spent 1 month in the British Library gathering all the sources, philosophical writings, going back to Bishop Berkeley in the late 18th century, because at least he was a consistent idealist. And on the basis of this work he did here, he wrote a book called Materialism and Imperial Criticism. Not exactly the most catchiest of titles, but nevertheless, it served its purpose. This was brought out a year later, in 1909. And this book was a marvellous book. It analyses again materialism and dialectics, and is certainly an important work from the point of view of a student discussing or learning about Marxist philosophy. So, Lenin spent a month of his time, didn't believe it was wasted. Lenin above all was a theoretician. In fact, if we wrote a particular paragraph or a sentence in What Is To Be Done, without revolutionary theory there cannot be a revolutionary movement. But theory is vital, it's the bedrock of the revolutionary movement. And therefore he was prepared to stand out as a defender of Marx and Engels. Marxism, even in a period of retreat. So this is an important theoretical milestone, this time that Marx spent at this particular flat in London. So I'm going to walk on the feet of Marx, or rather of Lenin. There we are. As I just mentioned earlier, Lenin arrived in London in April 1902. And the reason for that was the Iskra newspaper, which was established in 1900, which was being printed in Germany, could not be printed there any longer. There was some repression difficulties, and therefore they had to move the operation to London. Lenin through Plekhanov wrote to a man called Harry Quelch, who was the editor of a paper called Justice, the paper of the Social Democratic Federation. And he was also, we'll go to the Marx Memorial Library soon and we can see exactly his office and so on. But he wrote to Harry Quelch whether it was possible for Iskra to be printed in London. And he had the message returned, yes, it was possible and he's welcome to come. So they had a discussion. At this stage, there were six members of the editorial board of Iskra. And basically three of them decided to come to London and three of them stayed in Switzerland, along with Plekhanov, Axelrod and Postreyev. They remained in Switzerland, and Lenin, Martov and Vera Suzulich came to London in order to take care of the production of Iskra here. Lenin and Krupskaya managed to get the rooms, which we'll see further down the road there. But both Julius Martov and Vera Suzulich set up a home here. at this venue. And this was to be called the Den. Sorry, it was called the Den as well by Plekhanov, but this was to be called the Commune. And the reason for that, they hired, first of all, three rooms. Eventually, they hired five rooms in this building because the number of exiles from Russia came to stay for shorter or longer periods here. Also, there was a meeting room which they had hired, which I think was the first floor. And that's where they discussed the business of Iskra, because Lenin and Krupskaya lived in a flat, a two-room flat, not far away, but it was too small for meetings. And this is where the meetings took place to discuss the business of Iskra, of the editorial line, correspondence from Russia, and so on and so forth. I've got a few quotes here from Memories of Lenin by Krupskaya. This is the earliest edition, 1933 edition, which is fuller than the later editions. And if I can find the right pages, I'll let you know some information. As you can see, it's falling to pieces, yeah, the book, but nevertheless, we'll see it in a second. Let's have a look, yeah. Oh yeah, this place itself, according to Krupskaya, was used to produce illegal passports. At that time, particularly in Britain, you didn't really need a passport or paper to get around the place. But in Europe, sometimes you need passports. So they needed to forge passports. And Krupskaya writes in her memoirs that Peter Hermogenovich, I believe that's his name, who, at the insistence of Vladimir Ilyich, we christened the matron. He had just done a long stretch in prison. On his release, he became a fervent Iskraite. He considered himself a great expert in faking passports. He considered himself that the best method was to smear them with sweat. So if that would work, but nevertheless, at one time, all the tables in our commune, as they call this place, were turned upside down to serve as presses for fake passports. The whole of this technique was extremely primitive, as was all our secret work in those days. She then goes to the point that goes on, if I can find the place now. When others arrive in this particular building, at the beginning of September 1902, Babushkin arrived. We fixed him up in the commune, where he lived during the whole time of his stay in London. Two or three days after Babushkin arrived, we were astonished, says Krupskaya, on entering the commune, to find how clean everything was. All the litter was cleared up, newspapers neatly arranged on the table, and the floor swept. It appeared that Babushkin had put things in order. The Russian intellectual is always filthy, said Babushkin. He needs a servant, as he himself is incapable of tidying up. Soon afterwards, he left for Russia. We did not see him again after that. In 1906, he was caught in Siberia transporting arms, and along with other comrades was shot by an open grave. While Babushkin was yet in London, a whole group of Iskra comrades who had escaped from Kiev jail arrived. They were Bormann, Kraukmann, Blumenfeld, Wallach, and Tarisis. Blumenfeld had been incarcerated in Kiev jail after being caught on the frontier with addresses and a trunk full of literature that he was taking to Russia. I mentioned Blumenfeld because he was a compositor by trade, and he becomes the kind of business manager to organize Iskra. And he takes the, because although the 20th century press in the Marx Memorial Library had a printing press, It didn't have Russian compositive, compositive typeset. And therefore they had to go to East London, where there was several Russian printers, where they got the text typeset. It was then brought back by Blumenfeld to the printing press in 20th century, where they printed off copies and then showed them to Lenin. So he stayed here as well. And then, says Krupskaya, soon afterwards, Trotsky arrives from Siberia. At about that time, we learned from Samara that Bronstein, that is Trotsky, arrived there following his escape from Siberia. Trotsky arrived in October. I was going to quote this phrase when we went to the place in which she said it, because Trotsky turned up at Lenin's digs in down the road there. One morning, there was violent knocking at the front door. I knew full well if the knock was unusual, it must be for us. I hurried downstairs and opened the door. It was Trotsky, and I led him into the room. Vladimir Ilyich was only just awakened and still in bed. Leaving them together, I went to see the cabman and prepared coffee. When I returned, I found Vladimir Ilyich still seated on the bed, in animated conversation with Trotsky on some rather abstract theme. Both the hearty recommendations of the young eagle and this first conversation made Vladimir Ilyich pay particular attention to the newcomer. He talked with him a great deal and went with walks with him. In fact, I've got here the a quote from Trotsky. Trotsky lived here with Zasulich and with Martov. And in his My Life, he writes a paragraph about his experience, which I think is worth quoting. Krupskaya took me to a house a few blocks away, that's here, where lived Vera Zasulich, Martov and Blumenfeld, the Iskra printing press manager, and where they found a room for me. According to the English custom, the rooms were arranged vertically, as you can see, and not on the same floor as in Russia. The lowest room was occupied by the landlady, and the lodgers had rooms one upon the other. There was also a common room in which we drank coffee, smoked, and engaged in endless discussions. This room, thanks chiefly to Zasulich, but not without the help of Martov, was always in a state of utter disorder. Plekhanov, after his visit to the room, describes it as a den. He also mentioned in London, as well as later in Geneva, I met Zasulich and Martov much more often than we met Lenin. Since we lived in the same house in London and in Geneva, usually our meals at the same restaurants, I was with Martov and Zasulich several times a day. Whereas Lenin led the life of a family man, and every meeting with him, aside from the official meetings, was a small event. The bohemian habits and tastes, which weighed so heavily with Martov, were utterly alien to Lenin. He knew that time, yet ever so relative, was the most absolute of gifts. He spent a great deal of time in the library of the British Museum, where he carried on his theoretical studies and where he usually wrote his newspaper articles. With his assistance, I obtained admission to that sanctuary too. I was insatiable and simply gorged myself on the superabundance of books there. At least that gives you a bit of a flavour of this place. Not known to anybody, hasn't got any blue plaque, and yet here is where the theoretical discussions, the political discussions took place to produce the Iskra newspaper, where Lenin would come and discuss with the other comrades, where Plekhanov would come from abroad, come here to discuss with the comrades. So this is a very important place where a whole range of discussions would have happened, above all about perspectives for Russia and how to build the revolutionary movement in Russia itself, which we will explain a bit later on. I think this is quite a milestone of a place, really, although not recognised. Like the real birthplace of the Iskra movement, which eventually became Bolshevism. Is where Nikolai Alexandrov, Alexeyev, is his full name, lived. And he was an old Russian emigre. Was part of the revolutionary movement, but has been living in London quite a long time. I've been in touch with Plekhanov and Lenin, and he was there for he's the man who's going to help them when they arrived. And it was Alexeyev who managed to get Martov and Zasulich, that particular place up in Sidmouth Street. And he met Lenin, actually, as Lenin came off the train. And this is what Krupskaya says. First of all, we were astounded at the tremendous size of London. Although it was exceedingly dismal weather on the day of our arrival, Vladimir Ilyich's face immediately brightened up as he began casting serious glances at the stronghold of capitalism. We were met at the station by Nikolai Alexeyev, a comrade living in London in the emigration, who had a fine knowledge of English. At first he acted as our guide, and we were in a hopeless position ourselves. He goes on to explain how when they arrived there, they didn't know much English, obviously. Krupskaya learnt English from a book, and she actually translated the Webb's book, Industrial Democracy, into Russian. And Lenin also had a very rudimentary understanding of English. And they say when they came and heard English, they couldn't understand a word of it. And when they spoke it, no one could understand a word they were saying. So that's how difficult it was. And therefore they had to take in students, actually, on a kind of exchange basis, that they would teach them Russian, and in turn they would teach them English. And that's the way that Lenin and Krupskaya learnt quite a bit of English at that time. But this is a place where it's likely that Lenin and Krupskaya came for 2 weeks. As soon as they arrived, they had very nowhere to go, so they stayed at this place with Alexeyev and began to settle in, as it were. Then quite quickly afterwards, within 2 weeks, they moved. And they moved to a place up in about 5 minutes from here. So you can generally see the area is very, very closely compact in relation to Iskra agents and the workings of Iskra and the daily lives that they had. Obviously Lenin then went to the British Museum, which is not that far away, on a very regular basis as well, for a bit of peace and quiet. You know, everybody was on top of one another, if you like, because it was all overcrowded. So he needed peace and quiet to think and to write and to study. And therefore a lot of that was done in the British Library. After staying here about 2 weeks, they moved up to Halford Square, number 30. And that's where we'll go now, although it was bombed during the war. The actual place doesn't exist, but we'll take you to the spot, and we'll give you a bit of a history of what happened at that moment in time. Okay, any questions? No, very good, that's the way I like to see it. Yeah, Lenin visited London in April 1905 for the Third Congress of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party. But at this time, there'd been a split in the party between the Mensheviks and the Bolsheviks, and that the conference being held in London here at that time was a purely Bolshevik affair. The Mensheviks were meeting at the same time in Geneva, I believe, so some a long way away. So you can see how split and divided the party were, or was, at that time. This is a time also of the beginnings, really, of the Russian Revolution of 1905, which was going to have a big impact and allow Lenin to return to Russia. I think he managed to return to Russia for about 2 years and then pushed into exile again. He was all, generally his life was entirely in exile, as were all the Russian revolutionaries. They couldn't operate in Russia, only for this small breathing space during the revolution and just afterwards. So this was again an important meeting, an attempt to rally the Bolsheviks and to give them a perspective about what was happening in Russia itself. I understand that Lenin had arranged accommodation through Alexeyev again, and they went to various places for their food and accommodation in the King's Cross area. And again, the pub that we went to originally is probably where they ended up having meals and having drinks in the evening and so on and so on, relaxing and opening up a bit. They were given a small amount of money to subsist on, but nevertheless, they made the most of it, I think. So this is Lenin back in 1905. I have seen a film clip taken in 1942, in April 1942, to commemorate Lenin's birthday. That's where they opened up the, it was during the war, obviously. And it looks exactly like this. It looks exactly like this. So some of these houses here were bombed, and there was troops lined up on the buildings to listen. It's a mass audience, and the building itself had been bombed during the war. But a plaque had been unveiled by the ambassador Maskey, I think his name was, and there was a special tribute. A bust of Lenin was placed across the road. As far as I could tell, again, it's only by looking at this film, it looked as if this was the entrance here, and across the road there by the railings is where the bust was. So I'm not sure if that's 100% certain, but looking at the film, that's the way it looked. There was a factory to the left of us, that's obviously been demolished. That was quite a remarkable kind of celebration. Obviously, at that time, the Soviet Union was in alliance with Britain and America, and therefore they were friendly relations. And that's why things took place. And the sculptor, what's his name?
Lubetkin,
that's right.
Leopold.
He designed the bust that was being presented here. Just as a PS, the only thing I saw relevant to this was a cutting in the Financial Times, which was dated the 11th of December 2013, so it was 2 years ago, really. My grandfather's running with Lenin, it says. If you can believe this, you can believe anything. He says his grandfather lived in the same street. He was a little boy and came down and he was throwing snowballs at Lenin, and Lenin got hold of him and gave him a smack around the ear. That's what he said, and it's probably true, I just imagine, but that's a little ditty. When Lenin came over, I say he spent 2 weeks in the street that we just come from, and then for the next basically 12 months he would stay here. And Krupskaya, they had a one-bedroom flat. The landlady was Mrs. Yo, and she was a bit concerned that Krupskaya wasn't wearing a wedding ring at the time, but she was very reassured by those who recommended Lenin and his wife that they were above board, and everything was fine. As long as they put curtains in the window, they said. And quite soon afterwards, Krupskaya's mother came to stay with them. So obviously they'd hired the extra adjacent rooms. The two rooms were being hired in this particular building, in which they said they could actually eat meals like the English, in a family environment. because they didn't particularly like the English food, which was like oxtails and fried fish and other assorted English things that they didn't fancy too much. It is true that I can give us a number of quotes, but if I give them all. They were actually friends with two other Russians. Taktayev was a man and a woman who weren't supporters of Iskra. They were economists, actually, leader of the economist factions. But they were very friendly with Lenin and Krupskaya. They're the ones who got this particular apartment for them. And they went on social occasions with them. Krupskaya makes the point that they regularly took bus rides out into the, not just into the city, but also they visited Primrose Hill, where Engels used to live. And it gives you a great sight of London. And basically took all the as much advantage as possible to connect with the lives of working people in London. But it's obviously very difficult because of the language difficulties. Lenin did speak at a few meetings, not that many, mainly in East London, in Mile End, which is not too far away, to commemorate the Paris Commune. He spoke at one of the big halls there. Also, the SDF put on another meeting there, and Lenin spoke at it. Again, he also spoke, I believe, at the May Day rally in 1903. Before leaving London, he actually spoke in the Alexander Palace as one of the international speakers at the event, together with Keir Hardie and others. But he didn't venture too much into that area, I would say. His main concern was the building of the party, was the development of Iskra, and Yaira, which is Russian for Dawn, which is a theoretical magazine they also produced in London, but the main work was with Iskra. Krupskaya's main work was mainly gathering the correspondence from abroad and deciphering it, because obviously it was done in code. It had to be deciphered, written up, and prepared for publication if possible. And Lenin is very concerned about using the paper, as we will discuss a bit later, as the organizer of the revolution itself. Lenin used this pub, and the Bolshevik faction used this pub for meetings. We were told one story that the special branch were trying to find out information about this Lenin and these Bolsheviks, and they heard that they was having meetings here. So one of the detectives, London detective, went and went upstairs and hid behind some cupboard upstairs. And of course, Lenin's meeting began. The Bolshevik had a meeting. The problem was he was all in Russian. This poor old detective was stuck in a cupboard, all crouched up, listening to Russian, which he couldn't understand a word of all night. So that was the funny side of things. It is also said, it's not absolutely proved, but this was also the venue, at least one of the venues, for the famous Second Congress of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party, where the split took place between Mensheviks and Bolsheviks. As you know, that originally that they had a meeting in Brussels. That had to be abandoned. They came over then to, or rather to Denmark actually, it was abandoned in Copenhagen. And they came over to London and continued this particular Congress, the Second Congress. But they had to go to various venues, and it's believed that this pub was one of those venues. So that's quite an historical place, if that is the case. We can't go further up the road, unfortunately. If we went a few miles down the road, we'd come to Southgate Road, where the Fifth Congress of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party was held. This was a bigger conference altogether. This was in 1907, after the obviously the big flush of the 1905 revolution. which turned these small groups, the small Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks, into one party. Didn't actually split formally till 1912. They grew quite amazingly under the circumstances, where they had basically a few hundred thousand members. They had none of the conferences. There's only one congress, rather, that was ever held in Russia prior to 1917. And that was the first congress of the party, which was held in 1898. Nine individuals attended, in a place called Minsk. Basically within a fortnight, they were all arrested. That was it. So it became quite evident you could never hold an illegal congress in Russia, otherwise you had the danger of being arrested and exiled. So all the congresses was held outside. And one of those was in 1907, the fifth congress. As I said, it was a big congress of 300 individuals, of Mensheviks and Bolsheviks, a united congress. Lenin was there, Khrushchev was there, Trotsky was there, Zinoviev, Kamenev, Stalin, Rosa Luxemburg, a whole layer of people were there. And it was Harry Quelch, actually, who worked early on. He was one of the leaders, as I said, of the SDF, of the editor of Justice. He sponsored it, he managed to organize this event. It lasted 3 weeks. Unlike you get a conference this time, it lasts 3 days. This lasted 3 weeks. I know that Maxim Gorky attended, and he had a very famous actress wife who was quite well off, and they managed to provide food for the delegates. Each delegate was given £1 in order for the expenses to live, and so they had various places they lived around Germany, King's Cross. The only problem was that 3 weeks is a long time, and everybody ran out of money, and they didn't have enough money to get back to Russia, so they couldn't be stuck in London. So they panicked a bit. They're wondering what to do. So they tried to organise a fundraising event where Kihari was there, George Lansbury was there, a few others, but they didn't raise enough money. So eventually they managed to contact a Jewish revolutionary socialist who had become quite wealthy and owned a soap company in London, a bloke called Fells. And he was contacted about this problem, so he agreed to attend the Congress, which he did in the morning, listen to the Congress, and after listening agreed to pay £1,700 in order to get all the delegates back home, with the proviso that every delegate in the Congress signed a bit of paper that they were going to actually pay the money back within 6 months. Very foolish thing to do, nonetheless. They all agreed, and they all had a good laugh about it, apparently. So you have my thing, no problem. And of course, after the Congress ended, they all went back home. 6 months later, there was no money gathered to pay the bill. In fact, the conditions in Russia were far worse than ever before because of the counter-revolution and the reaction in Russia. They didn't have a cat in hell's chance of raising the money in Russia. So this Fells, unfortunately, had to wait and wait and wait. He died in 1914. He didn't have his money in 1914. But in 1922, the Russian government honoured the debt, and they paid the money to his widow. And I believe the IOU with all the signatures is in one of the museums in Russia at the present time. You should get a photocopy of it. That's the story about the fifth Congress. But now we go down here to see the bust of Lenin, which is in the small museum here, which is taken from this site to escape vandalism. It was brought to safety in this particular museum, which we'll go to on our way to the Marx Memorial Library.
I'll just tell you, this is the reading room, it goes without saying. There's a lot of great archives here, as well as general literature. This I'm going to refer to as the mural. It's actually a fresco because it's painted in the plaster. It's painted by, I'm doing that memory thing again now. It's painted in 1935, and it's painted by, let me just have a look, because I've just said it actually in the previous talk, and forgotten. Okay. Shit, my memory.
Riviera?
No, he's a pupil. I'll tell you in a minute, okay? He was a pupil of Diego Rivera, the Mexican artist. It was a guy called Jack Hastings. He's from an aristocratic background. Painted in 1935 in the plaster. Rivera, of course, had done the painting with Lenin in the Wall Street Stock Exchange, which they covered. This was also covered in here. And in living memory of now, it was uncovered. You know, they were discovered it behind things. So Hastings was painting from an aristocratic background, became interested in art, became interested in the socialist and communist movement. He was never a communist himself. Painted in 1935 under the influence of the communists. What's happening in 1935? There's the Karnovite movement, where they're just about to successfully achieve the first five-year plan in 1936. That the importance of that would be that it would break the monopoly of North America and Western Europe on mass industrialization, with the partial exception, geographical exception of Japan, partial exception. This would inspire this. So this is in that central piece is inspired by the Stakhanovist movement. At the top, you see the socialist thinkers: Robert Owen, Frederick Engels, Karl Marx, Lenin, William Morris, and we saw that banner of William Morris. Other comrades might know a little bit about William Morris. We can't go into that here. Also in 1935, it's that class against class position, or what the Trotskyist comrades call the third period, which was a very leftist period in the communist movement. So they reject parliament. It's a very leftist, it's just a direct attack of the working class on the bourgeoisie. And the lords and ladies and the bishops are just running for their lives. The workers are uprooting the foundations of capitalism. And it's as simple as that, basically. Here you see depicted the Britain's first working class movement, the Chartists, in the first half of the 19th century. And I say British, not English. Also behind them, the Tolpuddle Martyrs, the founders of, I'm not sure about English or British on this one, trade unionism. Obviously they were English, but I don't know whether it had a broader movement throughout Britain. Here, it's very white up to now, isn't it? It's very male up to now. I want you to remember that Britain is not a multi-ethnic society in 1935 to the same extent that we know now. Nevertheless, one might be a bit critical of it. I think it's important here that the people of the colonies, the British colonies, are depicted, which is very important. I think also what's very important is about the working class depicted in this painting, and one particular individual. At the turn of the 19th going into the 20th century, Britain's industrialisation had been built on its coal, particularly the quantity, but most importantly the quality of Britain's coal. So there would be around 1 million miners at the turn of the century going up to 1914, around 20 years before this is painted, around 1 million. They were the most important archetypal section of the British organised working class. But here, look, the woman in service, If there were 1 million coal miners in Britain, there would be about 1.3 million women in service, the unorganised working class, one of the most oppressed sections of the working class, subject to sexual abuse from their masters, subject to beatings from the thug mistress of the house, who would beat them with her rod and physically abuse them. So I think it's very important that the woman in service takes her place as a part, an important part, of the British working class. Finally, just to say, I'm interested in the depiction of the stereotypical depiction of the British housewife. She's got a rolling pin, she's got a little daughter. But look again, look at her posture. She's not passive, she's active. She's a leader. She's calling them forward. And look at her rolling pin. It's like a weapon, isn't it? So, I like it, but it's got its faults. But anyway.
That's perfect. What is to be done, which was obviously a classic of Marxism, and that was the decisive weapon by which he used to theoretically educate the comrades. That had been inspired, or rather the basis of that, was an article he had done a year earlier in April 1901, and it's published. I know you've got a file of Iskra, I think, on the desk there. Mm. I'm not sure which one it was, but in April he produced an article called Where to Begin, which again outlined the paper as the organizer of the of the party, because everything was so scattered that they needed to have a centralized organization. Yeah. The organization had to, the leadership had to be based outside of Russia, but but connected to Russia. Mm-hmm. And I think this is the real sort of enormous contribution that Lenin made. Yeah. Which was also to need to professionalise the party, because it was very amateurish as well up until this point, and as things go, and therefore that also led to one of the reasons for the split in 1903 at the Second Congress, because this was over very secondary issues, you know, the composition of the editorial board, and what was a member, you know, what was a sympathiser. You think, why do you want to split over that? That's ridiculous. It was an anticipation of the political differences that occurred between Bolshevism and Mensheviksem, and also is a need for professionalisation. The need for, as Lenin put it in What Is to Be Done, you need professional revolutionaries to dedicate themselves to building the party, not amateurs, not in the, you know, bourgeois intellectuals who come in and go out. You need people who are prepared to dedicate everything. And therefore, a lot of students, which is a good thing, I think, at that time, joined the revolutionary movement. And unlike today, if you like, I know we've got a bit of grumbles today about tuition fees and so on, they dedicated everything, their lives to the working class. And in fact, later on, Lenin was chided, you know, what are you doing? Young boys and young girls, that's all you've got. These young boys and young girls changed the world. That's the whole point. Of course, there was a battle that had to be waged between 1902 and 1917. It was a matter of 15 years. And Lenin and the Bolshevik Party were in power, and they changed the world. This was the element. So what you've got here is the kind of a place where Lenin thought his ideas through, not just the technically writing and the drafts of Iskra and checking the type, but also thinking of the perspectives, the class nature, the internationalism and so on that was required for the revolution itself. So it's, you know, this is an historic site as well, but history is part, as was said earlier, history is not simply about the past, it's about the future of learning. And the whole idea of this, I think, discussion and this walk is to spark interest in reading about the ideas of Marxism for this new generation to equip themselves for what is necessary in the next period with the biggest crisis of capitalism we've had. This is retying the knot of history in one sense, isn't it? That this new generation faced with this terrible capitalist crisis as we were before. Well, we failed before, but we can be victorious now on the basis of the theory and the ideas, particularly of Lenin, one of the greatest, I think, Marxist theoreticians of the movement. And understand, Lenin is the key to the future. So I think it's been brilliant just to come here and taste a bit of the history as well, feel a bit of the history that is here, and hope that will inspire us to go on further and further and further until the fundamental end of overthrowing capitalism internationally.